Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good morning and welcome to First United Methodist Church this morning on this first Sunday after Christmas. We hope you had a wonderful Christmas with family and friends, and we're grateful you're here with us this morning to continue our Christmas celebration. You'll notice all the candles are lit on our Advent wreath this morning. Each Sunday during Advent, we lit a different candle and a Christ candle on Christmas Eve. So Christmas has arrived, and we continue our celebration together, and again, we're grateful you're here with us today. Let us join together in our call to worship. Blessed is the season of Christmas.
The season which advances the whole world in a conspiracy of love.
Let us share together in our gospel reading from John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word was with God in the beginning. Everything came into being through the Word. And without the Word, nothing came into being. What came into being through the Word was life. And the life was the light for all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness doesn't extinguish the light. Let us stand together and sing our carols.
Thank you.
Please be seated. At this time, we'd like to ask the Gaylor family to please come forward that we might share together in the joy of the sacrament of holy baptism. A special time we share together in the community of faith, the sacrament of holy baptism, with family and friends in this community of faith who gathered together today to support this child and his family. Remember how Jesus was baptized centuries ago in River Jordan. And when he came up out of the waters, the Holy Spirit descended upon him like a dove and said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased." That same Spirit's with us today, hovering and blessing this child today, bringing them into this community of faith, surrounded by the love and support of that same Spirit that's with her and with us today and this community of faith as we share our love with her and her family.
Lan and Drew, as parents, do the two of you express and profess the Christian faith as expressed in the words of the Bible? If so, answer, we do. And do you believe Jesus to be our best example of what God's love is like? If so, answer, we do. Good. And will you nurture Evelyn Drew in the church so that by teaching an example, she may be guided to accept God's grace for herself, to profess her faith openly and sincerely, and to lead a Christian life? If so, answer, we will. You are here in the midst of your extended family and friends, and so I have a question to those of you right here in the front. Will each one of you love, support, and encourage Evelyn and her parents? And will you live your lives in ways that embody the goodness of God? If so, answer, we will. Good. Evelyn, may I see you? You look so pretty. Yeah. Oh. Hey, look. Oh. Would you like to see Mommy? You know what? We will do it that way. This is in her mind. Evelyn had this moment where she said, "Make the bad man go away." You know what? I think with your Mommy hold, gosh, it's better already, isn't it? Oh. Well, Evelyn, I'm going to ask your parents one more question. As parents, it is your privilege to give and to say out loud your daughter's full name. What name is given this child?
Evelyn Drew Gaylor.
Good. Evelyn Drew, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Evelyn, receive the sign of the cross and know that Christ dwells within you and will be with you always, all the days of your life. Amen. Lana, come on, let's go on a road trip, shall we? Let's walk over here. What we want to do is let everybody get a sense of how pretty Evelyn is this morning. And how lucky she is to have parents like her parents and grandparents and extended family members. And you know what? These people over here want to see you too. So come on over. We're going to come over here too. Because Evelyn, this is your faith family. This is the family of people that will love you and encourage you and be there to applaud for you as you grow up and you accept God's love in your own way and express your faith in your own way. And all this is God's gift offered to us without price.
Let's join together with our congregational response found in your bulletins. With God's help, we will so order our lives after the example of Christ that Evelyn Drew, surrounded by steadfast love, may be established in the faith and confirmed and strengthened in a way that leads to life eternal.
Hi, kids. Well, good morning. My name is Mr. Lance, and if this is your first time coming to church with us today, we're so glad that you're here with us. And normally during this time, what happens is we play a fun little song on the organ, and all the kids come up, and they sit on the steps, and then Mr. Mark, our children's minister, does a children's moment, and then all the kids and Mr. Mark go back to our academy. But today is a very special day in the life of our church. We all come together and worship as one whole family, and all of our volunteers in the kids' academy get a day off to rest and to be in worship with their family. So we're not going to do that today. Instead, I'm going to ask you to sit in your seats with your mom or your dad or your grandma or your grandpa, whoever brought you, but we still have a special message just for you kids today. And they asked me to fill in, and I have to tell you, it's really tough. Filling in for Dr. Brewster, not that scary. If you've never been here before, Mr. Mark is kind of the high school quarterback slash homecoming king of First United Methodist Church. He's easily the most popular guy in town, and filling in for him makes me really nervous. And it would make me a lot less nervous if you kids and adults would all just say good morning to me. So on the count of three, if you'd say good morning, Mr. Lance. 1, 2, 3.
Good morning.
This is like the only place in the world you get to call out your own good morning, and I really appreciate that. Okay, kids, so there is something special that happens in big church every once in a while, and sometimes you're not a part of it because you're back in the kids' academy and you haven't seen what it is before. And when I was a kid, I was a grumpy kid, and I didn't like doing anything that I didn't know why or that no one told me what was going to happen. So I'm going to tell you what's happening today is something called communion, and it's something really special that happens with grape juice and bread up here at the front. And I want to explain what it is and why we do it. And it has a lot to do with what happened in your life over these past week with Christmas. So now, kids and adults, I want you to raise your hand if you had a hard time going to sleep on Christmas Eve because you were so excited about Christmas. And then keep your hands up and keep raising them if you got up earlier than normal on Christmas morning than you normally get up. Keep raising more hands. Now raise your hands if you spent a lot of your day playing with toys and having fun on Christmas. Now raise your hand if you had to cook more food for more people than you normally do on Christmas. Now raise your hand if you had to have a lot of conversations that took a lot of your time and energy on Christmas you normally don't have. Now raise your hand if you had to drive in the car longer on Christmas than you normally do. Now raise your hand if you stayed up later in pajamas watching movies and being with your family than you normally are on Christmas. Now I've done a quick survey, and that's almost half of us. They did something like that on Christmas, and at the end of Christmas Day, I bet you were really tired. And I bet you what your mom and dad told you you needed to do was to go to bed and get a lot of sleep and a lot of rest, and then wake up early the next morning and have a big breakfast full of growing food to give your body the energy that you needed to keep going the next day. If that's right, say yes, Mr. Lance.
Yes.
I think that's right. But now God and Jesus know that there's more to us than just our body. There's our spirit too. And while all those things like playing and having fun and having conversations with your Uncle Jim make you tired, there are things that make your spirit tired. Things like worried, or things like being scared, or things like being lonely, or things like not knowing what's going to happen next. Those things make your spirit tired. And God knows that about you. And God says, well, if you're tired like that, I need you to rest. In fact, I need you to take a day of every single week just to rest, to come to my home, my church, to hear stories about me and how loved you are and how good you are, to give your spirit the energy for the next week. God says you need to rest your spirit. And Jesus also says, you know what you're going to need too? There's going to be times where you feel far from me, or where you feel lonely or scared or worried. And on his last day with us, Christ gave us this special meal. And he said, often I want you to take bread, and I want you to take juice, and I want you to go to my church and be with my people, and I want you to eat this meal in remembrance of me. So when you come forward in a little bit and you have a piece of bread and you have a piece of juice, it is a delicious snack because Methodists know how to do this. But it's also a special meal from Jesus, a special opportunity for food for your soul to give you the spirit and the energy that you need to rest and have another great week. Kids, we're so excited that you're in worship with us today. You're going to come forward just with your mom and dad and everybody else. You're going to kneel at the altar. You're going to hold your hands up, and you're going to receive communion as a special sign of Jesus's love for you. We'll be back to a normal schedule next week. Thank you for being here, and we're going to have a great time of worship. So, transitioning from that into our time of giving, normally we have a really cool little kids outro, but we don't have one today musically. So we're going to transition right into that. And if you've ever been in church before, you know that all the announcements the last Sunday of the year are about the budget. So I am going to give you that announcement with two quick pieces of information that you might not know. The fiscal year closes at the end of this year. All of the money that's given from this church needs to be received by the end of the calendar year. Our offices will be open to help facilitate with that. We also have ways to give online through the website. There's a new option of giving through text messaging that's also available. The number is listed on the back of your bulletin, as well as more information about fancy ways to give, like IRA rollovers and things that I don't understand because I went to a liberal arts school. The things that you might not know about the budget is the budget for this church is set by you, the church members. And the budget is just the way that we say, how is our church going to be in ministry to the community around us? How are we going to spread God's word to the people that need to hear it? And the budget for the upcoming year is set in the first few weeks of 2015. And when you, the church members who sit on our finance committee, set that budget, the first question that's going to be asked is, did the church support the ministries that we set out in 2014? With our 2014 budget. So the way that our budget ends over the course of this next week is gonna set whether the conversation in 2015 starts with increase or decrease. So thank you very much for considering that as you prayerfully consider your tithes and offerings for the end of the year. And the other thing you may not know is something that we don't like to talk about very much because it's personal. I wanna talk to you about my own personal giving. You'd probably never see me put any money in the basket because it's not passed out front. I tithe to the church out of electronic giving online. My wife tithes to the church through electronic giving, and we started giving proportionally to our income in our early 20s, and then really quickly after making that commitment, we received an employment opportunity that then allowed us to start tithing, giving 10% automatically to the church out of our paychecks. And we do that, we love the church, but we do that primarily as an act of worship with God. We do that because we know that we are people who are prone to worry, and we're people who are prone to forget that God is the source of everything in our lives. And giving that way allows us to acknowledge God in worship and saying, God, you're the source of it all. We love you. We trust you with everything that we have. You asked us to do this. We do this lovingly and with complete trust in you. And specifically, we tithe and give gifts to this church because we believe that this church is the church that's most wonderfully presented to share the word of Jesus Christ with the city of Fort Worth and the people around us. We believe that this church does amazing things for this community, and our gifts and our tithes go here because it's our church, and we are glad to be a part of it and to support it in its ministry here and in all of the world. So with that being said, would our ushers please come forward to receive God's tithes and offerings?
God, we are your holy people and your holy church. Please bless this act of worship while returning to you our tithes and our offerings. And let us do so with a joyful spirit, knowing you're the source of all things. And it's the name of your Son, Jesus, that we all pray and say, Amen.
Be seated. We'll offer our special appreciation to the morning song choir today for your wonderful music. Thank you all so much. Our gospel reading this morning is from Luke, so hear the good news today for our lives. After 8 days had passed, it was time to circumcise the child, and he was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. When the time came for their purification, according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male shall be designated as holy to the Lord. And they offered a sacrifice according to what is stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple, and when the parents brought the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, Master, Now you are dismissing your servant in peace, according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for the revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel. God speaks to us through the reading of Scripture. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for this day and every day, for our church and for every place of worship. We ask you to help us be alert to your presence and ready to respond to your love. We offer all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We see, we hear, we smell, we taste, we touch. We experience the world through our senses, and then we process these sensual experiences in our minds, and in our hearts, and in our souls. We repeat this pattern day after day, and we relish it on the extraordinary days of the year. Christmas Day. It was just 72 hours ago, give or take a few hours, depending on the specific starting time at your house. Late morning, mid-morning, early morning, middle of the night, 90 seconds after Santa finished the milk and cookies. Regardless of that starting point, it's Christmas Day that we remember most vividly. But what about the days leading up to Christmas? What stands out for you on the weekend of Thanksgiving, or that early part of December, or those festive and frantic last days before Christmas? What were the moments in which the Christmas season became real for you? Some moments are the same every year. Decorating your tree, putting up the outside lights, making that yummy holiday Chex Mix, going to Sundance Plaza, hearing that first great concert at school or at church, watching your favorite movie with a tasty mug of hot chocolate. And in almost every year, there are a handful of surprising and unexpected moments when God grabs us by the shoulders, shakes us up really good, and says, "Hey, I love you, and it's Christmas, so pay attention." This year, that moment happened for me at 9 a.m. on Wednesday, December 3rd. A couple weeks before that, my friend and coworker, Janet Ball, had pitched the idea of a Christmas cookie party. You know, bring 3 dozen cookies to share, recipes if you want to, bring some home, etc. It sounded easy. Janet was doing all the work. So I said yes, and we put it on the church calendar. I figured that it would be nice, but nothing out of the ordinary. My, how wrong I was. When I walked onto the second floor of the foundation building, I was greeted by the soothing voice of Bing Crosby. Yeah? That's it.
You can plan on me.
I was tempted to sing, but I didn't want to ruin the moment
snow,
with
her. And mistletoe and presents on the tree.
After hearing that, the first thing I saw was a Christmas tree on a table The always creative Janet had gone above and beyond to decorate the tree with silver cookie cutters, with objects like Christmas trees and elves and wreaths and snowmen. And our instructions were to put our name on the cookie cutter, drop it in a basket, and hope that it would be selected later on while we were together. Because if it was selected, then you would receive one of these beautifully wrapped Christmas gifts under the tree. I was not selected. However, it was fun to see the reaction of those that were and open up their gifts to see cookie cookbooks that they could take home and continue the fun. Now, my senses went into complete overload when I entered the Cookie Hall of Fame. It was literally a hallway with tables on both sides, tables filled with the look and the smell and the taste of absolutely delicious treasures. There was fudge and cake pops and muffins and reindeer cookies and red and green popcorn and more cookies. There were Christmas tablecloths and flavored coffee and cranberry cider and hot chocolate, of course. Over 30 people on our church staff stood in that hallway and then sat down at tables to taste and laugh and look and listen and live. It was a feast for the senses from a caring and generous friend, and it was a magical way to start the Advent train rolling through December. All aboard! Speaking of magical trains, can you imagine that it has been 10 years since the Polar Express movie came out and 30 years since the book was written? Since the movie is what most of us are familiar with, we probably associate the title with Tom Hanks. You know, that guy who has made a couple good movies over the decades, grossing, I think, about $8.4 billion worldwide so far. He's the narrator of the Polar Express, and he plays five other characters. Of course, we know him best as the conductor. The conductor who guides us to the North Pole and makes certain that we return home with an open heart and a renewed spirit. It is the conductor who has that perceptive statement on the cover of our bulletin: seeing is believing, but sometimes the most real things in the world are the things we can't see. It isn't just one sense that gives us faith that grows into belief. It is truly all of our senses. Wonder, faith, belief are the amazing gifts that had already been given by Chris Van Allsburg's classic book. You can say that Van Allsburg has been the Tom Hanks of children's literature. He graduated from the University of Michigan with a degree in architecture and design. He focused on sculpture and drawing, leading to a moment when his wife told him that she loved his preliminary sketches and thought that they would make great illustrations for children's books. She was right. By 1985, he had illustrated and written The Polar Express. 10 years after the book was published, Van Allsburg used an incredible story to describe his ultimate inspiration. He said, "Many people have asked me how I came up with the idea for The Polar Express. I've always avoided giving an honest answer, but now my conscience obliges me to tell the truth. I stole the story from a little beggar child who shared the tale with me after I purchased a box of matches from him one cold, snowy night. He was a charming red-haired boy with extraordinary green eyes. When he finished his story, he offered to sell me a small bell, which he took from his pocket. It was broken, so I quickly understood the reason that he told me his tale of the train. And the $5 he asked was far too much for a broken bell. But when I handed it back to him and saw the sad look in his eyes, I took out my wallet and gave him all that I had. After I offered him the money, the boy dropped the bell back into my hand, and it rang beautifully, like some kind of heavenly chime. I turned to the streetlight to get a better look, and when I turned back, the boy had vanished. When I got home that night, I wrote down his story, making small changes and pretending that it was mine. Now, for those of you that have read the book, do you remember the last line? The last line goes like this: "Though I've grown old, the bell still rings for me, as it does for all who truly believe." As far as we know, as far as the text says, Simeon was already an old man. He had eagerly anticipated the fulfillment of God's redemptive work in the world, which I think means that his senses were on high alert for a sign. A sign, a flesh and bones expression of God's love and promises. No matter how long he had to wait, he would eventually see and hear and hold the Messiah. The text doesn't say whether Simeon expected God to do this through a child, but it does say that he was pulled to the temple that day by the Holy Spirit. And I think it's fun to imagine that the prompting inside of him was as sweet and clear as the ringing of a bell. In addition to Simeon, God was busy with Mary and Joseph, using the law as the vehicle to lead them to the temple so that they could fulfill their parental responsibilities. So it was both inspiration and dedication that created this tender, rich moment, a moment for a faithful believer to literally take God's salvation in his arms and hold on to it with every bit of tenderness and strength that he possessed. The Polar Express and the presentation of Jesus in the temple share an important common thread: that mystery, celebration, and belief should be part of our daily experiences instead of reserved for a once-a-year holiday or a once-in-a-lifetime experience. Our challenge is to find meaningful rituals for celebrating the presence of God in our ordinary moments of life. We can do it. We can greet each new day with gratitude. We can feast on the goodness of family and friends. And we can end each day with a fulfillment that sounds a lot like the ringing of a bell. One of the best rituals that we can embrace is communion. It really is a means of grace and a feast for the senses. As if the spirit behind Janet Ball's cookie party and Chris Van Allsburg's epic tale were blended together in the breaking of the bread and the sharing of the cup. When Lamar Smith speaks those familiar words in a moment, and when he looks you in the eye, and when he consecrates the elements, you will know beyond the shadow of a doubt that you are loved. Loved by God and sustained by your family, your friends, and this faith community. Whenever the table is set, you are welcome. There is always an open seat on the train. There is always room for one more. Jesus embraces us at the communion rail, and then sends us out into a world that longs to hear the music of his presence. Seeing is believing, but sometimes the most real things in the world are the things we can't see. How do we know this is true? Our senses tell us so. Amen. As Dr. Smith comes forward, I invite you now to turn to your bulletin so that we can prepare for the sacrament of communion. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Let
us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right
and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, O God, creator of heaven and earth. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. As Mary and Joseph went from Galilee to Bethlehem and there found no room, so Mary went from Galilee to Jerusalem and was despised and rejected. As in the poverty of a stable, Jesus was born, so by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. As your word became flesh, born of woman, on that night long ago, on the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The body of Christ broken for you. When the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to you, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The blood of Christ shed for you And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We want to invite our servers to come forward now at this time, and once we have served one another, we look forward to serving you. Let me give a couple pieces of instruction. First of all, the most important thing, and that is to say, in the United Methodist Church, we celebrate open communion, which means that every time the communion is served, you are welcome. Age does not matter. Whether you're a member of this church or any other church does not matter, for we are equally loved by God. The method that we will use today is called intinction, where you will take a piece of bread, dip it into the chalice of juice, and receive both symbols together. We are going to invite you to come forward to the communion rail to either stand or kneel, whichever is more comfortable. If any of you cannot come forward, whether it's from the main level or from the balcony, please let an usher know and we will come to you before we finish serving. The table has been set. Our Lord is the host, and you are invited to come.
Rejoice, rejoice, rejoice.
were unable because of physical reasons to come forward to the rail, please get the attention of an usher. We'll be happy to serve you in your seat. And now, please turn your attention to the bulletin as we say together our prayer after receiving. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We've reached the time in our service today where we throw open the doors of our church and we ask, is today the day? Is today the day? And in response to the incarnation of Christmas and the mystery of communion, you say yes to God's call by joining this portion of the body of Christ, our church. There are many different ways to join the First United Methodist Church of Fort Worth. The easiest one is to simply come forward now during as we all stand and sing together our hymn of invitation, number 224, Good Christian Friends Rejoice. Please stand together as we sing.
Denomination. Of course, we accept his baptism and his faith journey, and we welcome him into the United Methodist Church with this question: will you now be faithful to the United Methodist Church and support it with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness?
Yes, I will.
God bless you. We're delighted to have you as a part of us.
Thank you.
And good news, buddy.
Oh, come in here. How are you?
How you doing?
Tell me your name.
William Haynes.
H-A-Y-E-N. Haynes.
A-N.
William, and who are all these beautiful people with you?
Madeline May.
Hi, Madeline.
William.
Hi, William.
Sydney Grace.
Wow.
And my wife, Sandy.
Sandy, we're so pleased you all have come today to be a part of us. I am familiar with your name. I've had you on my list.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And we're so delighted to have them come. Where has your membership been?
It's been a while. We've been attending here. We just haven't officially joined.
Okay. Dr. Brewster always gives to folks coming in this vow that I gave Steve. I'll just give it to you, too. Will you be faithful to the United Methodist Church and support it with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness?
Yes.
You're a part of us, and we're delighted to have you. I'm going to ask these folks to remain here, and this is Leah. She'll be their first friend, and we'll be in touch with them and continue to welcome them into our church family. After the benediction, I hope you'll come down and welcome these folks into our church family. We're just delighted to have them come.
If you all would, why don't you come over here toward the center, and that'll welcome to you, and it'll make it easy for people to come down and say good morning and greet you. Well, friends, our gathering will soon be ended. Where will we go, and what will we do? Then may grace and peace and hope and love and joy forever accompany you. Amen.